Hi everyone, I'm Mick Pletcher, and just to introduce myself, I'm the one that runs, co-runs the Nashville PowerShell Group. We've been around for a couple of years, and we meet once a month. Any of you all are welcome to come. All you have to do is go to our meetup site, go to the Nashville PowerShell User Group, just Google that, and we'll be the first one to appear in your Google. So today I'm just here to teach you a beginner's class on PowerShell programming. It's definitely, I'm sure most of y'all know, it's definitely the thing to use for Windows environments. I've been in PowerShell now almost 5 years. I converted over from Visual Basic and scripting VBS. And now it was well worth it. I can tell you that right now. I use it for automation. I've written all kinds of automation techniques for doing stuff with System Center, which I'm actually an SCCM admin. Automating different reporting techniques. I now have gotten PowerShell where it's got hooks into Orchestrator and generate automatic reports from System Center, Configuration Manager, and tons of stuff you can do with it. So any questions before we get started? Anybody here have experience with PowerShell? Just trying to get a, find out how close or how experienced any of you all are, and just wanted to.
What's the most exciting thing you can do with PowerShell that most people might not know about?
Well, of course, this is a hacking conference. You can actually write viruses with it.
Yeah. Really?
Yes, there are actually, I wouldn't call it exciting, at least ones on my side.
Yeah.
But yes, there are actual PowerShell viruses out there. And there is hacking. I think probably the most exciting thing, which I haven't, I did it for personal only, because I know Facebook would come down on me.
Okay.
But I've written actually a Facebook defriended app using PowerShell that tracks who's defriended me on there.
Wow.
So that's probably the, one of the most exciting things I've done with PowerShell, if you call that exciting.
Cool.
But any other questions? All right. Well, getting started into PowerShell, first thing you do is actually have a command prompt. And all you have to do is come in here, type in PowerShell, voila, you're right there. It looks almost exactly like regular command line, which, as you'll see, many of the actual commands that you have in PowerShell are the same thing. One of the things I want to go over with is references. When you're getting started out in PowerShell, these three references I'm going to give you are the most important. At least they have been for me. They helped me out drastically when I first started learning. The first one is if you go to the site ss64.com. That site has all the reference materials on what each command does, gives you examples. It's definitely well worth going to that site. Another site, of course, is the MSDN. You just go to msdn.microsoft.com/PowerShell. Microsoft has the same thing. It's a little more technical than the SS64. The SS64 is more user-friendly on giving reference. And then finally, computerperformance.co.uk. That's the other site that I've always used for referencing, and it's awesome also. If you have questions on PowerShell, these three sites will help you more than anything. They're all Facebook groups. In the three sites, all you have to do is type in Facebook search PowerShell. And the first one literally is called just PowerShell. First group, second group is PowerShell scripting. And the third group is the scripting guys, which I'm sure everybody here has heard of. Those three sites, if you've got questions, if you get hung up in PowerShell, go out there, post something. There are lots of PowerShell MVPs that post there all the time, and they'll help you like that. So that's those three sites, and believe me, I've used them a lot. Even still today, when I try to do hooks into other apps, I'm using them. The first thing you want to do on a system is, once you get your PowerShell up, you got to make sure that you're set to remote sign on your execution policy. Your execution policy basically is a security feature in the Windows environment that stops a PowerShell script from actually executing. And there are several different settings. So the way you know what policy you have is, you go in here and you type in git-dash execution policy.
Is there tab completion in PowerShell?
I'm sorry?
Is there tab completion in PowerShell?
Get dash and then execution policy, one word?
Yeah, get dash execution policy, then you hit enter.
I didn't do it right.
Get dash execution.
Get dash, and with that, no spaces.
Right. It's all one word.
Okay,
and so I don't know if that's going to actually respond to your own. Oh, no, it is. Okay.
Yeah,
okay, so what you can do, the next thing is, restricted is going to keep you from running any PowerShell scripts.
Okay.
So the first thing we want to do is change that. So if you come in here and you type set dash execution policy, space, and I set mine to remote sign. Remote sign typically is the safest one. It allows you to run everything on your network. So it's all one word.
Mm-hmm. See, is there a way to increase the font size?
I think so.
Sure.
Sorry about that.
No, it's
now it says remote sign, so I changed it.
Full screen.
I can't see.
So we're all SSH in the same user, so whoever changes to remote sign, you just change it for everyone.
Thank
you.
Okay.
Can I increase the size of these?
Yeah, just pick a larger number.
Oh, I see it. I was seeing, looking at this one. You're right. All right.
20. Mm-hmm. 24.
You think
there we go.
18, 20?
Yeah, blast away.
All right. Is that good?
Yeah, that's better.
Okay, good. Okay, so you do set dash execution policy space. Mine's already set to remote sign, but I'm going to do it again. Remote sign. And voila. All you have to do then is go back and type in get execution policy again, and it'll tell you what your system is set at. This is the security policy that that is initially set on all systems, restricted. And it is something that... Go ahead.
I was going to say, is this the same for the multiple Windows version 7, 8?
Yes.
10?
Yep, it is. And you can go out, if you're an admin, and set these via group policy, what level of restriction that you want. So that's the first thing that has to be done. The second thing is, you probably want to know what version of PowerShell is actually installed on your system. Now, all systems, if you're starting out with Windows 7, are going to start out with PowerShell version 2. There's actually now PowerShell version 5. The way you find out is you come in here at the PowerShell prompt and you type dollar sign, you type in PS version table.
Capital there.
It doesn't have to be capitalized, but I just do it. And then this will tell you what version of PowerShell that you're running.
5.0.1024.
That's... You're on the latest, and which is the latest one they pushed. I'm still on 4.
Here's how I'm not PowerShell. Is this Microsoft?
Yes, this is all Microsoft.
Okay. Yep. And are there, I know on my exchange, is there PowerShell for that? Is that like a different kind of PowerShell, or is it all the same?
The difference is, okay, if you're in Exchange, yes. What version of Exchange do you have?
23.
Oh, it's Exchange is built on the PowerShell platform. So everything that you do with Exchange can be controlled with PowerShell.
Yeah.
All the System Center suite, most all the server applications now, they're have hooks right in PowerShell. In fact, they're built on the PowerShell platform. So it's that powerful. So as you can see, I'm still on version 4. That's all you're looking for is the PS version. So if you come, if you're starting out version 2 is fine, because until you start getting up using, which I'll cover this later, using modules, you're going to be doing the basics. 2.0 covers everything that you would be doing as a basic PowerShell scripter. So once you get that down, then we're going to get right into actually using PowerShell. So when you're at a command prompt, you don't actually have to be in the PowerShell prompt. You can come out of this. All you have to do is type exit. So let's say we want to run an actual PowerShell script. Well, we don't have to go in there. We can actually run PowerShell-file, and we just call, make a quick PowerShell script here.
Unfortunately, we can't do this part.
Right.
Maybe if like Bart PE supports PowerShell.
And PowerShell is, you can edit it straight out of a, because it's pure ASCII. So you can edit it straight out of any notepad, any editor that you want to use. It doesn't require any special editor. I'm just going to make one that'll do And yes, there are your regular commands. So I got my test right here. And we're going to do dash file. Which one am I? Okay. And there we go. All I did was just create a simple PowerShell script. That's how you can actually execute one from command prompt. You just type PowerShell dash file and then the actual name of the PS1. PowerShell scripts are all PS1 files.
It would need that remote execution policy set first, right?
Yes.
Before you do that?
Yes. You will need that part set first in order to be able to execute this. And so there you go. And there are many commands. A lot of people are afraid to go into PowerShell, but PowerShell is not a whole lot different from command line. You can come in here, but we're gonna go right back into PowerShell and I'll show you. So there you go. You just saw me do a simple clear screen. There's a simple dir. You've got change directory, cd. You've got a lot of your same commands.
If you made the default application for test.ps1 to be PowerShell, would it then execute that?
No, it doesn't. What you have to do, if you want to come in here, like I execute it from the command prompt, but if you want to execute it from here, you would just right-click and you have to run with PowerShell. That's a good question. A lot of people get that mixed up. They think that you can just double-click. If you double-click, it's just going to open up the editor on a PowerShell script. So you definitely need to right-click and run with PowerShell. If you all come, and I'll give you the address. Actually, it's mickit.com. It's my blog, and I blog all kinds of PowerShell scripts out there. And you can go out there and get, there's a plug-in here that will give you the access to, which I have already implemented on this one, run as administrator. It has the registry key to allow PS1s to run as admin. So, yeah, that's a really good question. So, as you can see, we did a simple DIR, and it just gave us, it looks a little different, but it gave us a basic directory listing. The difference here with PowerShell and using your DOS is this DIR, we can assign it to an actual variable in memory. So let's say we want to do assign this, let's say directory, call the variable directory. Okay, so we just executed that. Now if we type in directory, now it's assigned to an actual variable. The cool thing about this variable is, the moment it did the directory, when we did that earlier, these are objects in PowerShell. You can access any one of these objects individually. So let's say we want to do, and by the way, you can hit the up arrow key and it'll go back as, it'll recall your last commands that you had executed. So let's say we just want to look at the name fields, what name files are in there. So if we do directory.name, there you go. You're only pulling the names up. But it gives you a lot of flexibility there. Once you get these objects in here and assigned to a variable. So one of the things, the first things that, once you get past your actual basic commands in PowerShell, the next thing are the actual commandlets. And that's what they're called in PowerShell. They're called commandlets. A commandlet is basically a verb-noun. you'll see it'll be called, like you'll see a commandlet called, let's say get-item, or set-item, remove-item. What you're doing is you need to identify first, what am I wanting to do in PowerShell? Well, let's say I want to create a new file, a new text file. A file in PowerShell is classified as an item. So let's say I want to go in here, create a new text file. So what we can do is create a folder here. Let me do this in PowerShell instead of create the folder that way. So first thing we want to do is create a test folder. And what we're going to do is, it's called new-item. And let's say we don't know how to use new item. Well, we can just type in new item, and bam, it will pop up the necessary commandlets in there. It'll pop up the necessary fields that have to be filled out. So let's say the path of this. So I know my directory here. So we're going to create this directory. Now you'll see, I'm going to hit enter, it's asking for another path. You can, in this command alone, the new item, you can create multiple items using one command line. I don't want to create anything more, so I'm just going to hit enter. Now it's asking me the type. The type is it a directory or is it a file? That's how it differentiates. Which one? It can also create registry keys too, a new item can. An item is also classified as a it can do registry keys, files, and directories. If you type in, let's say a registry key, H key, local machines, so on, you don't have to identify it then. It knows right off, hey, it had H key, local machine, for instance, in there. So I know I'm creating a registry key, and you don't have to identify the type. It's just a directory or a file that you have to identify. Do what?
Is it a version difference?
What did it do when you...
It just created it.
Did it create the folder? You created a file. I was gonna touch on that. You see the mode right there where it says A? Uh-huh. That when you see an A in there, that means it created a file. Okay. What he's talking about is, let me go ahead and create this. So I'm going to say directory. And there you go. You touched on a good part I was going to cover. So mine put a D in the first field. If you create a file, it puts an A in the second field there. So you know which one you created. So as you'll see, I'm just going to drag it over here.
Can you show us what it would be if you type the command fully out?
Sure. That's I'm getting ready to do that next. I'm just guiding you through if you're brand new and you need a little help. And then we're going to do the get help next, and then I'm going to show you the whole command typed out.
And you can type command and then the command, like so man get item and get my command name.
Right. So here's the directory it created right here. So let's say we want to do this as a full command. Well, I'm going to delete this. Well, actually, we'll delete it from here. So we want to get rid of the test we just created. So we can come in here and actually type in remove-item. It's still an item, but we're removing the item this time. That's where you got to just kind of logically think. Your verb, which is the first part of it, is what will change. Your item is what stays. And there are lots of different nouns out here to use. So,
and
so we're going to
derive from, like, see, or Microsoft Sharp or something?
This is off of .NET Framework. And it does have hooks into the, of course it's built on the .NET Framework platform, but you can actually access .NET Framework commands directly using PowerShell. So we're going to remove this item, and this is how it would actually look at in putting it in a full command line. So we're going to type in -path, \\backslash, users. and then we're going to hit enter. And there you go. It disappeared off the screen. So basically, we didn't have to specify when you're doing a remove. You don't have to specify what type it is, only when you're creating. Sometimes now, you'll have, let's say you're removing a folder, and let's say maybe it's protected. It's a read-only folder, and a normal delete, you can type in after that dash force, and it won't delete it at that point. And that's a command that I pretty much use on everything I write is dash force, because I never know if it's a read-only directory. Let's say I'm creating some new file or new directory underneath it. I want it to be able to do it whether or not it's protected or not. So that's how you actually create a new directory and delete one. We're going to go back and create one, recreate it.
Didn't have success. I had an error.
What did it do on yours?
It says, remove item cannot find path because it does not exist, but when I do dir, I can see that the item still exists.
And
so
if
maybe
you...
maybe I didn't type it right.
Oh, that doesn't work on there. Okay. I was thinking maybe like I was doing there, it was, alright, type in. There you go. Okay. So type in remove dash item.
So now you can make your new file, you know, new item space.
That's really C shell
space.
Back first.
Okay. So
and then path space and then whatever the.
And there's my test item.
It's weird that you
can
still use.
Yeah,
this called test.
And then space dash force.
Well, I didn't do it that way.
There you go.
Now let me see if it went away. It's gone.
That's it. Right. So there was a perfect example. She ran into that perfect example right there. It would not delete the file until she put a dash force after.
Okay.
So that's why I always make sure on most of my stuff that I include that at the very end. So I'm going to go back here and recreate this folder.
Oh, it's in tight.
Well, somebody else in my directory.
Are we all in the same directory?
Yeah. Somebody else made a test.
Yeah, that
was,
I made one.
Wouldn't let you delete it.
I made a file called test.
Oh, me too. That was probably one.
Maybe we can delete it.
Yeah. Maybe we can delete it.
So we got my folder back, and let's say we want to rename. You can rename an item, too. There's all kinds of different things, like all the item stuff, you can do a get, set, new, rename, copy. You can copy the items. They used to not have that. And that's dealing with files.
We determined why it didn't prompt me for this file side directory.
For what, when you're removing?
No, when I was creating that.
Because what happens is it defaults to a file. If you don't type in, and actually this said type, but if you're doing it from a command line, I'll show you this. So if you're doing this from a command line here, okay, so if you're doing this from a command line, if you type just this in, it's going to create a file, test01. But if you type in dash item, item type, directory, there you go. And that created it right here. So you definitely have to type in item type. It defaults to file.
But when we were doing the other up there, we put new item and then what prompt?
It may be different in 5 now, because I'm using 4 right now, so they may have actually changed that where it doesn't prompt you now.
Okay, that makes sense.
But
Yeah, so if you want to do it as a full command line, which is at some point you definitely want to start being able to do, that's what you would type right there. And the only difference is you would put file. If it's, like I said earlier, if it's a registry key, you just put your reg key in there. And a tip on doing registry keys, you have to do like HKLM:// and then that. That's the way. You can't do H key, you know, where it's all spelled out, underscore local machine and all. So it has to be HKLM.
And now, does that actually populate a registry, or does it create a file for the registry?
It depends on what you're creating. You can populate, you can create a key, you can do everything in a registry.
Put it right in?
Yes. You can you can make changes, you can remove keys using this, all that. So, next thing, so we're going to go back because it should still be in memory. So there was the snapshot I took of the directory. So as I was showing you all, you've got your pipes, and you can actually pipe to these objects. That's what PowerShell is really good at. It's good at making objects.
Sure. You created a variable directory and linked it to dir. When you change dir, adding additional files and things, does it actually change the object?
I was going to go with that.
A new object?
No, it's a snapshot.
Okay.
So if anything gets added or deleted to this, it's not going to show it. That's a snapshot at the time I ran it. That's a good question.
That's a good way to compare if you have friends still use.
Yes. Exactly.
Could you repeat that again? I'm sorry.
When you do, what he was asking was, when I ran this command right here, assigning dir to directory, is it basically dynamic? No, it's not. It's a snapshot. So whatever is in this now is all that's going to be in the directory variable that I assigned to.
As soon as you exit PowerShell, it's gone, is what you're saying?
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Oh,
definitely. So the next thing is, the next step that you want to go when you're in here is, of course, part of PowerShell is you want to learn how to make if statements. If this happens, then I want the script to do this. It's actually pretty easy to do. So we can start out, and I just wanted to say the reason I'm doing all this from command line right now is because that's how I actually learned PowerShell. I didn't actually come in here and start scripting right off the bat. I just started replacing command line using PowerShell, so I got used to the commands. Then I took it to the next step of actually writing scripts. So let's say we're going to do our directory first and see what's in there so we know what to... Okay, so let's start with an if statement. So we always do an if statement. You always have to have your parentheses there. You can't do anything without everything being in a parenthesis. So we're going to do if the directory, and this is where we're actually accessing, that's where your columns come into play. So we can do a comparison straight with just the names in that directory. So let's say if the directory is equal, and this is another thing right here that trips a lot of people up, and believe me, I still make this mistake too, coming from VB. Your operands. Your operands are totally different from all the other operating systems you've ever seen. They don't use symbols in any of it. Equals is dash EQ, greater than dash GT, less than dash LT. So you got to get used to the fact that it's not your typical greater than equal to symbols, the equal symbol, any of that. So that and believe me, that still trips me up.
What's not equal to?
Dash NE.
Okay.
But the nice thing about operands in here is you've got not just your regular set of operands, you've got stuff like dash like. Do you want to see if, hey, is there something in here like, and you put percent, let's say like temp. We got two things here, temp and temp path. Well, you can do if directory name dash like parentheses percent temp percent, it'll find both of them.
that's the advantage in here. There's also other ones called match. You can match up. So you want to make sure that there's something exactly like this in there. It'll search for anything that matches that. So the operands are pretty cool. It's just getting around, getting used to the different wording that they use. So we're going to do dash equals. And let's say config. And then you need the curly brackets. That's what comes next in your if statements. So you do your regular parentheses, and then you do curly brackets for your then and else statements. So we're going to do curly bracket, and I'm just going to write this out to the screen. So the write host command exist. So basically what I'm saying is, if directory name is equal to config sys, then write to the screen. That's what write host does. Write to the screen, it exists.
Is there a PowerShell specific host that is one you can create and it's a batch or whatever? So that like when you do that, you just like get return and then get your curly brace and everything.
You're saying like be able to do a conversion between the two?
No, not so much conversion, but just format your code so that it's readable.
Oh, definitely. Yes, there is. And when I get into the ISE here in a little while, I'll show you the convention. Because I was brought up in, when I went to college, software engineering, and I still use software engineering techniques when I'm like declaring, disposing of my variables, all that. Not many scripters do it, but here's one of my arguments for declaring and disposing my variables. It's not necessary in PowerShell. But if you're in there and you're debugging, and I mean, some of my scripts have been 1,000, 2,000 lines long, you're debugging, you're going through, and that list keeps on growing and bigger and bigger and bigger of variables in there, and you haven't disposed of them. Imagine when you get to one and you're trying to find it, you know, and you're in another function, and that list is so long. That's why I declare and dispose of all my variables, just for that reason.
And so is the alligator brackets there, or... are they working as a then?
Yes.
So if and then?
There is no then in here, but there is else. So basically, yes, you're right. This immediately would be, in like if you're in Pascal, it would be a then statement immediately after. And there you go. It does exist in there. It found it. But back to what you were asking, yes, you can do a... else statement. So there you go, that's actually an else, and it'll look a lot better when I go into the ISE to actually edit this at that point. Yeah, you can do your script straight from here, doing the if-then-else statement. Well, let me bring you into the ISE and show you that. And that's just an FYI, talking about the ISE, which is the script editor that's built into the Windows operating system for PowerShell. That's what the icon looks like when you go in. So if you just double-click on it, this one's not associated. If we go in here, right-click, and edit... here you go. So that's the Windows PowerShell ISE that comes integrated. I will tell you this, I don't use this. I use PowerShell Studio that my firm bought me, but this is a great tool. If you're going to use this, which you probably will at the beginning, download steroids, ISE steroids. It's a great plug-in, and it gives you tons of options in here to be able to use this. So this was my original one, so we're going to go in here and actually do an if statement, like you were wanting to actually see how it looks in a PowerShell script. So, sign. And this is one of the nice things about using the ISE. As you can see, the moment I type the dollar sign, it has a pop-up and lists commands already in memory that that use the dollar sign. So I'm going to assign directory dollar. All right. So then, as you can see, it automatically does the drop downs for me. So let me go back here and show you that.
On your declaration, is it assigning a type based on what it sees over there on the right, or is it just like, say, variant for the variable?
You're saying it is, so.
I mean, it knows it's a type directory, right?
Yes.
And it, because of the command it sees there?
Well, it doesn't know that yet. I take it back. Yes, it does. Sorry, you are right about that. Yes, it does. So it automatically filled this in because DIR is a built-in command in PowerShell. So PowerShell already knows.
Okay, so if you threw it some other values, that's just a value, do you also have to declare a type, or will it?
I do, like I said earlier, I do declare types, which I'll show you how you can do that here in a little bit. So as you can see already, it's already got all the fields for a DR, and I'm just going to use the name field here. That's one of the nice things about using ISE. When you start to use commandlets in here, you'll get the help right with them. That's a huge, huge help. So we're going to do dash, and there you go. This is what I was talking about earlier. Here's all your operands when you're entering an if statement. So you got like your bit. You've got bit fields like the XOR, XAND, all those. Your AND. You got, that's right, I forgot about that. You got contains, if it's a string. So you got a ton of different operands in here. There's your I like. You can do is, if it's like a, is does like a, if it's a, string value, for instance, or is an integer, checking the type. So it's very powerful on this part, but we're looking for equals. Yep. And where are some of the do our open bracket. This is just how I write it because I'm still used to from my old Pascal and those C days. So we're going to go in here. So if it's equal to that, we're going to write a host. Now the write host file, or I'm sorry, a write host commandlet, that basically writes directly to the screen. It's a huge no-no. If you talk to Don Jones or any of them, they're gonna crucify you on that. They don't like it. The reason they don't like you using it is because it's writing directly to the screen, it's not an object. And they want you to write to an object that will output to the screen. Because you want all your data going into an object to be able to control the data output. Basically that's their reasoning. I use write host, the only reason I use write host is because on a lot of my scripts that I write, the outputs, I color code them, and write host is the only command in PowerShell that you can color code your output. Which is the only reason I definitely use it. So you're going to write sys. And actually that mistake I just made is a good point here. If you're putting a field in here, like let's say test PS1, let's say test PS1 had a quotation mark in it. The way you do quotation mark in one of these is you use, which it, actually it's legal to use these even for this, you would use that symbol right there. And then you can put actual quotation marks in between that. The single quote. Yeah, and that'll allow you to put your quotes in between on that. Like for instance, I had a script actually I was writing earlier today that we the output had to have quotes in it, and so I just used the singles around it and it assigned that to the variable.
Is the converse true also to have an apostrophe S or something, you know, double quotes outside of this?
You know, that's a good question. I don't know on that. I've never actually run into a script yet that I've actually needed, you know, a single. Likely not. I'm guessing no on that. I tell you a way that I get around that a lot is by doing this. So let's say I'm going to do a test caps on equals, and so let's say I want it called mix with an apostrophe S. So the way I do that is, so I would type this plus char, that's a character. Same thing as in BB where it's CHR, so it's CHAR. And then that's 36, I believe. And there you go. That would put mix, the apostrophe, and then S.
So for your alphanumerics, the concatenation is a plus sign.
Yes.
Not the ampersand.
Right. So anytime you're wanting to make a, like this is going to be a string, you just put the plus in there, and for stuff like what you said, I use the ASCII table and the characters. Same thing if I need quotation marks in there. Sometimes I'll do the single, but sometimes a lot of times I'll just do this. That way I know. And I do that a lot when I need spaces in between characters. So that way I don't miss it. I know exactly, hey, there's that ASCII input there, character 32, and I know that's a space. And I don't, it's easy to miss that in there. So I usually do that. So let's run this. So you can come up here and you can run the script here. Got to save it first, and there you go. It did my success. Yes, test PS1 exists, and then this actually, I forgot to output this. So what you can do is to output it back out to the screen. All you have to do is type the variable in, and in the moment it runs, we run this. Oh, actually, that was a dollar sign.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, whatever it is.
Shots up there.
Yeah. So that's basically how that works. And so anytime you want it, there's two ways you can output your text. You can either type in the actual variable that you put in here initially, or you can put in a write host. And there you go. It does the same thing by doing either one of them. I typically don't use write host. I just call the variable up by itself, and then that'll output that directly to the screen.
Could we see if the font could be made larger in this screen?
Oh, sure.
Also?
No problem. Is that better?
Bigger still.
Is that good? Okay, good. All right, so as you can see my output down here, so it basically, that succeeded. And as you saw, I used the actual, apostrophes right there instead of the regular quotation marks, and it still did the same thing. So that's all it really takes. Now, if you want to, and I know you wanted to see this, so let's say you want to do else. So all you have to do is do else. And And as you can see, it automatically fills out what I was typing. And we're going to do... not a success. So let's do a... it's not equal. Well, probably because it still was a success because it is actually there and it's doing that test. Well, there you go. I guess because it's still there.
There's something
that and there's other stuff in that directory that it still was successful. Gonna try the like. Yeah, you see, as I was talking about, it automatically knew. Now, if we type in like test, see, all I had to do is put in partial of that, and it was able to see, yes, there is something out there that's like test. That's part of what is so cool about PowerShell. Is you can just put a portion of the string value in there and it can tell you what is there.
Can you manipulate like more? Like, I only want to look for things that are like this up to four characters in, or like, you know, play with it more than that, or is it just like or not?
You can, so you're wanting to like.
See,
like
when I look at the first five characters,
how like
the file name or something like that. I don't know why you would, but.
Yes, you can.
Yeah?
You could do, for instance, you could do, let's say, TE%. I'm trying to think which one it is. TE.
Oh.
Ah, there you go. It's the ampersand. I mean the star.
Okay.
So yeah, you can do is like TE and then the star in there, and that's the symbol for a wild card.
Cool.
When you're doing these. So that's all that is. So let's say, let's say in our directory here, so we're going to do, and you can actually come down here while you're doing this, you can come down here and work straight from there if you want to see.
Like is sort of like basically a regex. You can kind of do that. So you can kind of put like expressions in there to kind of do the searches.
Oh, exactly. You can. So we know we got our directory there, the full list of everything in there. So let's say we want to iterate through that list. Instead of like doing a search like this, let's say we want to iterate through each item in that variable. Well, we can do that by using the for command. So we can do for each, and then we're going to call... So we're going to do, we know the directory contains a list of files in there, so we're going to go through and iterate through each one. So we're going to use the for each command. The for each command basically is going to pull up each item in that assigned variable, and it's going to iterate through the whole list. So we're going to do for each file in the directory, and we're going to do this, put a close bracket. Now, I'm just going to let it display the file the whole thing. And when I run this, it brought up the same thing. It was able to iterate through each one. Well, if I did like file dot name, there you go. And that will let you iterate through each item in an array. Because that's basically what this is, this variable now. It's an array that contains all the lists of the files in there. And this for each statement is allowing me to assign each item as it iterates through each item to the variable file for me to actually process and look at.
So on your file.name, the .name part, is that considered a property of that object?
Yes. In fact, let me show you this. So... So when I type in file and then hit the dot, it brings up all the fields that are available in that assigned item. So that's where I just scroll down. And like you can use full name, which will actually include the directory along with the name, which I only did name, but that's all you have to do to iterate through everything on here. And then, let's see, some of the features in here. So in this, this is where you can go in and using your ISE, you can come in here, go to the add-ons, open the add-ons tools, and that's where I was talking about get the steroids for it. It'll open up Microsoft's website, and it's, I have to say, it's awesome. Even though I don't use it, I've had friends that are using it, and they said that it's well worth it.
I still prefer that one over this PowerShell Studio, but it does cost.
Is it, do they charge?
It's like a trial, yeah. It's, I don't know, it's been a while. It might be like $100 or something like that. It's not required. It just once you've actually done it for a long time, it adds a lot of additional features that actually start to really benefit you a whole lot, but might not be all that beneficial at the very beginning because it's just way too much too quick. So it's like if you actually get into it and get into actually doing this, then that's when you might want to start looking at that. And then the company that makes it, they have like the way I actually got it is I was testing it and trying it out, and then I didn't think anything of it, but they have this like program where you can like write a blog post or do something like that about it, and if they like it, they can then give you a free license. So that's how I got my license. Because when I was getting into it, I like doing themes that, you know, especially with like my eyes and stuff, there's like certain themes that I particularly like that don't bother my eyes real bad. So I had made that theme and I kind of broke down their like XML kind of scheme, like template that they had for where they store their themes, and I just commented everything out and just like made it really nice and showed exactly what everything changed and made a blog post about that and actually got a free license. But it adds a lot of like additional features, like, you know, you can set you know, things like kind of like you set rules, and it has like all these rules for like proper syntax, and if you catch errors or catchable things you might have messed up, or format everything into the proper way you want it. Like brackets are all the same way, you know, spacings are the same way, pads the same way, that sort of thing.
And you're right, because one of the things it'll do, like and this again, this goes back to my C programming days, but yeah, it will automatically, like if you set it up, it'll automatically, like on your brackets, put a bracket here and then put the other bracket there, such stuff as that, just for formatting. One of the other things that they have here, let's see.
Yeah, and with PowerShell too, curly bracket placement on a new line or not, else on a new line or not, that's still kind of like a holy war there. People can't agree.
Exactly. So in here, if you come into the commands window here, you can actually pull up, let's say, add registry key item. And it will give you the details. It'll give you all the fields. You can go in here and actually fill these fields out. So let's say I'm gonna do a data type. Well, let me actually come down to something that's probably easier. Get a Git service, which is one of the other things I was going to go over. That's another very commonly used one, the get service command. So basically what the get service command is, it gets you all the tasks that are currently running on your system. You need a list of tasks on there, that's what this will do. And you can do just like I've done here with the directory, assign that to a variable, and then search through. You can, if you need to end one of them, same format goes like with service. You gotta think this is service. So you can get a service, you can stop a service, start a service, restart a service. That's the kind of mentality you gotta start thinking about. Like a service, an item,
whatever you're looking for, registry. You just got to think of it in that kind of mindset, and then think of, what do I want to do with it? So let's say we want to do, get a service. Well, we're just going to, there's no reason to fill these out because we can actually get all of the, so there you go. It gives us a list of all the services that are running. So let's say we want to actually do it in here. So we do, services equal get dash service. And services. So there you go. And now it's actually assigned to the variable services and it's got a list of all of them. Well, now we can actually, now that we have that list, we can actually go through here, pick a service we're looking for, and that's where the if statement would come back in. Let's say we're looking for a service. Let's say this is a script that we know on a specific server, this one service for some reason stops every now and then. We want it automated. If it stopped, restart it. Well, we can actually do that. So we get the list of services. Let's just say WWAN service. So if, well, first thing we probably need to do is find out what actually is available to us when we do it. So we do dot services. I'm looking for a name in here. Maybe that's not a good one to use. What we can do is, if you don't know, like I thought, that's a good example. I thought it would be called name. Apparently it's not. So we can go in here. Actually it is. There's our fields right there. If we don't know what it's actually called, and it didn't show it when, you know, when I typed in services dot, it didn't show name, we can just go in here and look at this and see what actually the fields are that we can use. So we're gonna come back up in here and just do services dot name. Save this, and there you go. That's one of them. That's a good example right there. Like what I said earlier, that it will typically fill out, tell you what's there. This one didn't. The only reason I knew name existed was because when I actually did the output screen, I saw it was one of the fields there, one of the columns that was available. And when I entered that, there you go. There, it filled it out. So that's a good example of one where you gotta sometimes dig a little deeper than PowerShell. ISE doesn't always tutor you the best.
You can also pipe to a git-member, and it'll give you all of the fields like that.
Yes. I usually, like on the beginner classes, I don't cover piping. And the only reason I don't cover piping is because for a lot of people, piping is just the most difficult thing to learn in PowerShell for a lot of people. It's not hard, but it's just hard to get the concept down. Basically, what piping does is, like what he was talking about here. So let's say I did, just to show you an example, services, and a pipe is your vertical line, and get dash member. So let's say I don't want to, I just want this displayed, I don't want anything else on our disk to come back. This is your, if you put a pound sign in front of it, I guess hashtag some people call it now. Mm-hmm. If you put a hashtag in front of it, it will comment it out. That's the commenting in here. If you want to, another thing is if you want to comment a whole bunch of lines, you do less than symbol, hashtag, and then everything down beneath that will be commented, and then you do a hashtag and then greater than symbol at the very end to do a whole bunch of lines at once. So if we do that and run it, There you go. That's exactly what you were talking about. It got the members.
I think the most confusing thing about learning piping in PowerShell, where it's different, say, if you're doing it on a Unix server or batch or something like that, is that if you are piping into something, it's going to be expecting a certain type of object. And if you pipe a string into something that wants an integer, then it's going to, you know, spit out an error for you. So you have to make sure your objects you're passing are piped correctly.
Exactly. And the thing about piping is, it's nice, it's convenient for length of scripts, but it's not necessary. It's just to make your script a little shorter. That's all it does. Most of the scripts I post out on the net, I don't use piping, just for the fact that I want them to be understood by most people, no matter what their level is. So that's the main reason I don't use piping. But it does come in handy, no doubt. So yeah, that's a really good example right there. So basically when I did the get member, it tells what each one of these, let me actually give a little more here. And there you go, that's what it's telling, the name of it, and actually what it's a member of in PowerShell, in the output. So that's basically what piping is. That's about all I'm going to cover, because it's something that you probably want to learn on down the line. You're learning PowerShell.
And next year we will try to come up with a way that we can get a GUI.
Exactly. Exactly. Well, I think that's pretty much it for today. And I hope it's giving you all a little bit of an insight into using PowerShell. And believe me, it's a really powerful tool when using the Microsoft environment. Everything is has already gone to it. If you're wondering about it in VBScript, there are less than a handful of things that VBScript has over PowerShell still, and they're just obscure things, but otherwise PowerShell is definitely the way to go. Any other questions?
Thanks a lot.
Yeah, maybe.